We're going to find ourselves, we pre-adventure, to find ourselves in 1 Peter 2. If you can go there with me, 1 Peter, oh, that's better. 1 Peter 2, we're going to read verses 4, 5, and 9. Say 4, 5, and 9. Look to your neighbor, say, neighbor, you look like God. Tell your other neighbor, neighbor, you look like God. Can I explain myself to you? May I take time to explain myself to you? In the presence of God, God gives us two characteristics that we have. He gives us the royalty, the kingship or a queenship anointing, and he gives us the royal anointing. How many people know that Jesus was the King of Kings and he was the Lord of Lords, but he also was the high priest of our hearts? Amen. So he had both the kingly anointing and the priestly anointing. And if he gives, he's passed that on to us through the adoption, through the Spirit of God, then we must also look like him. Say, I look like God. I'm getting ready to teach you something, because sometimes we get offended when somebody say, you look like God, or no, I don't feel like I look like God. I've been going through what I've been going through. God is not looking at your present. God is looking at who you are in the spirit and who you are in the future. Look to the same, say, God, thank you for looking past me and looking into my future, because I look like God. Tell your neighbor, you look like God. And God is royalty. Say royalty. Say, I am royalty. I like that. I am royalty. The message today deals with Purim in a new way. Purim, of course, is, you find that in the book of Esther. And of course, Queen Esther, whose real name was Hadassah, she begins to be not drafted in, but she is the fairest of them all when Queen Vashti gets kicked out of the kingdom. She didn't get killed, but she got kicked out. Look to them, they said kicked out. Sometimes you got to understand your role in your position. Amen. So Esther, out of all the future concubines and future wives that the king could choose from, he chose to find favor on Esther. I come to tell you today that all the future prophets, all the future evangelism, God has found favor on you. You've been at this church for a while. You know, you are at Favorland, the land of the favorites or the favorites of God. But I'm not talking about that. God has taken you, plucked you out of who you thought you were, and put you in a place of where you're in favor with the king. Say, I'm in favor with the king. And when you're in favor with the king, he has promoted you to royalty. Say, I'm royalty. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. So 1 Peter 2 and 4, we begin to read. It says, to whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God. Look to your neighbor, say, chosen of God. And what the writer Peter is saying is in his letter to his followers is that although Jesus came, he was pushed away by men, but he was chosen by God. Don't you know that you are royalty? Look at it and say, I'm royalty. And you might not have been royalty to man. You not might be royalty to woman, but you have been chosen by God. Look at this, I've been chosen by God. It doesn't matter how I look, it doesn't matter where my finances is. I've been chosen by God. I've married into the good bloodline. Look to them and say, I'm married into the good bloodline. Even if you're not married, you can say, I'm married into the good bloodline. My name has been changed. I've been grafted in. You have been into a royal family, baby. And no matter, you might be 39th in position, 39th to the kingdom, but you are still in the bloodline. Look to them and say, I'm still in the bloodline. The good thing is you didn't have to kill nobody to get there. When you came to the front of the church, shook the pastor's hand, said, I'm giving my life to Christ for real, you immediately got put in the bloodline. You immediately became royalty. That's what's so powerful. You can have and this is the blessing of it. In the kingdom, say in the kingdom. When you're royalty, can't nobody pull that away from you. Even if you abdicate your power, just like when we were watching, what I don't remember the name of the series we were watching, but The Crown. We were watching The Crown on Netflix. He abdicated his power for a minute, but he was still the king. He might have been exiled to another place, but they still put him up with money. They still put him up with land. They still put him up with authority, and he still had his power. Looked in there and said, you still got your power. So even if you give up who you are, you still have your authority. You can always get it back. Looked in there and said, I'll get it back. So we're going to preach today. Can I preach today? I know I normally give you some Bible study and some teaching, but today I just feel like going. Can I just go for a moment? It says, to whom coming as unto a living stone disallowed. Got to take these glasses off. But God, chosen of God, precious. Say precious. But look what the writer says. This is why I can tell you that God intended us to be royalty. Look at it, say he intended us to be royalty. We're not supposed to be broke down, busted, and disgusted. We're supposed to look like God. And I believe right now in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, the Holy One of Israel, that I declare in this place that if you're in here, you are chosen, right priesthood of God. You are royal. Look in there. I'm royalty, baby. I'm royalty, baby. I'm royalty. Oh, I might be sick, but I'm royalty, baby. I might be broke, but I'm royalty, baby. I might have problems in my life, but I am royalty, baby. You can't take that back. Can't nobody take it away from you. Look in there and say, can't nobody take that away from me. My position has been etched in stone. Ain't a headstone. It's the laws of God that got your position. By matter of fact, the Bible tells you you are a living stone. Say a living stone. Say ye also. Why don't you talk to somebody? Y'all got to be proactive, and I want y'all to talk to somebody. Get somebody in your eye gate and tell them you also. As a living stone, I'll build up a spiritual house. Look to your neighbor and say, I'm building up a spiritual house. My temple's getting spiritual. My body's getting temple. Don't you know your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, right? You built up a spiritual house. This is the meaning of what Peter was saying. He said, he ain't not talking about you building temples onto yourself. He's saying you need to build up your holy temple, your personal temple, and build it up. Say, build it up. Look what the writer says. The writer, Peter, brings up a great point. He says, you are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood. Look to your neighbor and say, I'm holy. Look to your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm holy. You know how? It says it right here. That's right. Point to your book. Say, this has been passed to me from generation to generation. I'm chosen. Say, I'm chosen. It says, to offer up spiritual sacrifice. Oh, this is where it gets it. A holy priesthood got to offer up some spiritual sacrifices. Men and women of God, I come to tell you today, my beloved, that if you do not willing to sacrifice of yourself, if you're not willing to sacrifice of your finances, if you're not willing to sacrifice of your time, if you're not willing to sacrifice of the things that you find most precious, God is not willing to put his priesthood mantle on you. What it says is you got to be willing to give up of yourself, give up of your time, give up of your heart, give up of your love, give up of your joy, and going to pass it on to somebody else. Sacrifice yours for somebody else, and that establishes you as a holy priesthood. The reason why the body of Christ isn't thriving is because they don't know about sacrifice, baby. You might need to lose some things in order to gain some things. You got to be willing to lose. I love that text, because you got to be willing to lose in order to gain. Somebody need to put that on Facebook. Willing to lose in order to gain. So I'm going to lose something. I'm going to get rid of something Sometimes you got to lose some friends. Sometimes you got to let go of some family members. Sometimes you need to let go of a little finances. Whatever it is, sometimes you got to let it go in order to gain God. What's interesting is we'll give the job 40 hours, but we won't give God 10, 2 or 3 on a Sunday. What amazes me that we're willing to go overtime for a workplace that's only gonna give you finances, but you're not willing to go overtime for the Lord that got your eternal life. What I'm telling you is there's got to be some sweat equity in your breakthrough. There's got to be some sweat equity in your healing. There's got to be some sweat equity in your breakthrough. But I remember when we used to go to another church, and you could see around 12 o'clock, everybody started looking at their watches because the man of God went past 30 minutes. He'd give you a word and begin to minister, and all of a sudden, 12 o'clock, they're looking at, man, am I going to make this Chiefs game? Am I going to make this lunch? And they begin to, why? Because they were not willing to put in the work to receive their breakthrough. I'm talking to somebody today that there's an appointment. This is appointment television right here at Glory Bible Fellowship International Church. Get here by 10. Sometimes you'll be out by 12:30 or 1, whatever it is. If you make the appointment, God will make the breakthrough. If you make the appointment, God will make the healing. If you make the appointment, God will make your increase. If you make the appointment, your healing, your deliverance, your breakthrough will manifest. The reason why we miss out is because we're not willing to make the appointment. We're not willing to come into the house of the Lord. We're not willing to build up our own faith. We're not willing to build up our breakthrough. We're not willing to build up our children. We're not willing to build us up in the Word. We're not willing. Do I got any help up in here? We need to be willing. We need to be willing. Say, I'm willing. I'm willing because I'm chosen. I'm chosen because I'm willing. Look to the neighbor and say, amen. Amen. Let's keep reading. He said, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. But you are chosen. Say, I'm chosen. Verse 9. Talk to your neighbor. Say, you are chosen. You're a chosen generation. I come to tell you that the generational is powerful, right? Generational is powerful. Remember, just think about your season being a generation. A generation ranges between 18 to 40 years. I want you to get that in your spirit for a moment. Because not only is this my season is a generation. Say, I am chosen a generation. This is my season, baby. You get to say, this is my season, baby. This is it. This is my time. I've been called out. I've been set apart. I've been sanctified. I am ready because I've been chosen. Say, I'm chosen. I'm chosen. Anybody want to hear me today? Anybody want to understand what I'm getting ready to tell you? I'm going to already unpack the text because you'll find out through the Bible how many times God claims you to be a chosen generation. How many people God claims you to be a royal priesthood? How many times God claims you to be a holy nation? Look to them and say, I'm holy. I'm royalty, baby. Anybody royal? Anybody royal? Do I got any kings and queens in the house? Are you feeling the love? I don't feel the love right now. Are you a king and a queen in this house? If you're a king or a queen, why don't you get up and do your royal wave? You know, the wave it's not like this. The royal wave is just like a cupping of the hand. Nice and easy. This is my wave. And you gotta let the subjects, them demons that are subject to you, they let me help y'all out. Too many people have been subject to the demons, but I come to tell you the demons are subject to you, and you gonna kiss them away, say you are no longer beloved, get out. You got to go. You peasant demons of poverty, you got to go. You peasant demons of lack, you got to go. You peasant demons of sickness and disease, you got to go. You peasant demons of debt, you got to go. You peasant demons of addiction, you got to go. You peasant demons of adultery, fornication, pornography, you got to go. You peasant demons of witchcraft, you got to go. Whatever it is, that demon got to go. You just wave them goodbye, baby. You got enough authority in you that when you do it, you got little marchers, angels that go and do what you've been called. They act on your behalf. Look to them and say, they act on my behalf. It says, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. I don't care when they say you look funny. That's right. I accept that. I might act funny. I might look funny, but I am chosen by God. A peculiar people means you look different than the rest of the people. Royalty does. Royalty give you access, baby. You got access because you bold. Say, I'm bold. And I'm bold because I got what? Access. Y'all, we learned that on Wednesday, see? You are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, peculiar people that should show forth the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. This is the key line in the whole text. I want you to get this. Highlight it. Do whatever you need to do in your app, your book, your Bible. Your Bible doesn't power down. I love that from Kenneth Copeland. Say, my Bible don't have an on and off switch. It's open. It's on all the time. And we have to be willing to understand that the reason why you have been chosen, say the reason why I have been chosen is because I'm supposed to be the praises of him who called me out of darkness into the marvelous light. I need to look like God so much that people want to follow me out of darkness. I need to look like God so much that people want to follow me out of hell. I need to look like God so much that when I start walking by, demons begin to tremble. I need to look like God so much that they say, have you caused me to go before my time? The answer is yes, you got to go, devil. Yes, you got to go, spirits. And you need to be walking in God so much that you can lead people out of darkness. You need to be like Peter Piper. Lead people. Say, I'm leading people. When you got to say amen, amen. Say, I got this. I'm royalty, baby. I'm royalty, baby. If you're royalty, just say, I'm royalty, baby. Can I prove it to you biblically? Can I go and prove it to you biblically? Go with me to the book of Revelations. The book of Revelations. We started in the middle of the book or towards the latter half of the book. Now we get into the end of the book, but I will go to the, you know what? Let's go to the front of the book first. Go with me to the book of Exodus. Exodus 19. And we'll read verses 5 and 6. And this is powerful because God began to give you a word like never before. And it started in the beginning. We're going to go from the beginning to the middle to the end, and you're going to see how many times God has chosen you. Say, God has chosen me. I recognize it now because he's been yelling and I haven't been listening. Exodus 19, you got it? Now, therefore, if you obey my voice, what does he say? If you obey what? Whose voice? Y'all need to write that down. Say, royalty obeys God's voice. Royalty obeys God's voice. I'm royalty, baby. Look at this. And keep my covenant. Look to your neighbor and say, and keep the covenant. Keep God's word. He started this off in Exodus, baby. That means if you're doing the feast, you already on the road to redemption. If you're doing, if you're tithing, and if you're doing your offering, you already on the path. If you're doing the things of God, already you are already walking the things of royalty. Royalty has been trained up. They do the same because they've been trained the same. They have somebody in the chamber already prepared to them on how they're supposed to dress, look, walk, and what the marching orders and how you go before the king. Look to your neighbors. I know how to go before the king. I never come before the king empty-handed. That's why I got Deuteronomy 16:16. You're supposed to come with an offer, and I came with an offer. What I'm saying to you, God is getting ready to do some things. You need to just be in order. Look to your neighbors. I'm in order. I'm in order. Now I said, now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed, keep my commandments, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above what? He put you above all people. Look to this, above all people. Y'all got to catch this. The reason why I think yourself not so high, I come to tell you that my Bible says I need to think as high as God thinks for me. The Bible didn't tell me I can't think high. It just don't think myself too high. I'm telling you today, I don't think myself too high because God has put me above all normal people. God has put me in a place where I am the king. I'm representing the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. I'm the earth ambassador of God here on the earth. So I follow special rules and privileges that you might not have, that you might not have. So when they look at me and say, you look funny, you look like you special, it's because I am special, baby. Yes, I do things different than you. No, I'm not going to cut corners. No, I'm going to do it the right way God had me to do it. They want you to cut corners and not follow direction. And no, I'm going to do it the way God wants you to do it. He said, I put me above all people, for all the earth is mine. Look at this. And you shall be unto me a kingdom of priests, a holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. It's what Moses got that from God. And delivered it to the people. Looked at it and said, I got it. I got it. I got it. So you got a couple points. One, kings obey the voice of the Lord. Two, they keep his covenant. Looked at it and said, they keep his covenant. Now I'm going to give you some more. Y'all got it? We good? So now we go to the book of Colossians. Colossians 3:12-14. We're going to find some more. You got, 2 points already, right? You obey the voice of the Lord. Look to the neighbor and say, obey the voice of the Lord. And secondly is what? Keep his covenant. Keep his word. Say, I'm going to keep his word. And sub note, I'm going to keep my word. Royal people don't lie. They don't need to lie because they make the rules. So I don't need to lie because God make the rules, and I'm his earth ambassador. Let me just help y'all out. If God speak a word, whether it happened for you or not, God's word cannot return to him void, and God cannot be a liar, so it's getting ready to happen to you. Y'all go catch this. That's why it's important when a king decree a thing, it is so. I believe there's some kings and queens in this place. I believe there's some royalty in this place. I believe there's some people that will be raised up that have the ability to decree some things and it be so. Anybody got anything to decree? Anybody got anything to say? I feel like I'm getting ready to decree no poverty at GBFIC. I believe that I'm getting ready to decree no lack at GBFIC. I begin to decree that there's no sickness and disease at GBFIC. I begin to decree free, that there's no pain, no hurt, no harm, no danger at GBFIC. I declare and decree that in Glory Bible Fellowship International Church, everybody shall walk in prosperity. I decree, anybody want to help me today? I decree that if you're at Glory Bible Fellowship International Church, and you're a tithe-paying member, you have full rights and privileges to the blessings of God. If you haven't received them yet, that's because you haven't declared the thing. I believe that if we open up the Bible, we start declaring as kings and queens that we shall have what we declare. The Bible tells you that if you believe it, it is so, because you declared it out of your mouth and you didn't disbelieve, but you had faith enough of God to believe it. So I declare that what you've been asking for in secret, if you declare it out of your mouth and you believe in your heart, it shall manifest. Anybody want to manifest to me? Say, I'm promoted. Because all promotion comes from the Lord. Say, I decree it in Jesus' name. And if that promotion don't come on this job, that means I'm just getting ready to get a better job, better location, more pay, closer to home. Whatever you want to decree, you need to be decreeing those things. You know what? If that job's too far, I declare and decree that my job is moving closer to me, not me moving closer to my job. I declare and decree that every time I open up my bank account, that every time I go on the telephone, every time I look at a mobile app, my bank account, it goes up, never goes down. I decree it in Jesus' name. I decree that that when I go to the doctor says I'm 100% healthy and everything that's in me is working in proper order. I decree it in Jesus' name. Anybody want to decree like that? I decree that although anger has tried to attach me, I rebuke it and anger stays off of me in Jesus' name. If you can believe this, start decreeing some things, God will manifest your breakthrough. You need to open up your mouth and start decreeing. Just take 2 minutes to decree some things. I decree my healing. I decree my body is being 100% whole. I decree that there's no sugar diabetes on my family line. I'm going back through years and years of family line history. I decree that my family line's blood is clean from any sickness and disease. I don't hear enough. I don't hear enough declarations going on. I don't hear enough decrees coming on. If you don't even know what to decree, just decree something. Just get something in your mouth, and I promise you, God will decree it for you. I believe God will heal you. I believe God will deliver you. I believe that God will give you a financial breakthrough. I believe that pride will be moved away. Jealousy goes away. Envy goes away. I decree those things in you right now. Any kings in this house? Any queens in this house? If you're a king, just raise your hand. If you're a queen, raise your hand. Say, in Jesus' name, I decree everything that I announced just now shall manifest on my behalf. I'm not holding anything back. So God is not going to hold anything back from me. The Bible tells me that God would not hold any good thing from me. So I receive that. I decree it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Put on, therefore, verse 12, as the elect of God. Look to him, it said the elect of God. The chosen elect. Say, I'm the chosen elect. I am special, baby. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, you are looking at royalty. And I am special, baby. I am special. And not short bus special neither. I am special. Y'all not saying it. Y'all don't want to say it. Y'all don't want to say it. Say, I am special. And I'm not short bus special. I need y'all to know that. Say, I am special but I'm not short bus special. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Y'all know what I'm talking about. My class don't start 15 minutes earlier. It ends 15 minutes earlier. Because I need extra time to walk between classes. No, I am supernaturally healed mentally, emotionally, physically, and spiritually. Say, my body is 100% healed in Jesus' name. Okay, look, I want you to read this because I want you to get this in your spirit because there's so much word in this one text that God is going to do whatever you want God to do on your behalf. Look at this. But it takes a commitment. Say it takes a commitment. This is the point. That's point number three. It takes a commitment. You got to what? Obey the voice of the Lord. Keep God's covenant. And it takes a commitment. Look what you're committed to before you say it, but look. Put on, therefore, as elect of God, holy and beloved. Look at this, I'm beloved. He said, put on bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long suffering. This commitment starting to get in writing. You need to write this down to yourself. Highlight it, whatever you need to do, because you're getting ready to commit to some stuff. I'll get ready to talk to y'all. Some of y'all have already signed up to be a royalty, but you got a commitment to keep. Say, I got a commitment to keep. Can I tell you that when you become Miss Universe or Mr. Universe, not only do you win the prize, but there's a year-long commitment that you must keep. Y'all not talking to me. There are press availabilities that you must go to. There are promotional events that you must go to. There's things, although your schedule might not have allowed it, that you have to make changes to get in line with your commitment. Some of us need to make some changes to get in line with our commitment. I might be a Mr. Universe, but now I need to change my program to get in God's commitment. What does that mean? That means there's going to be some Sundays that although I don't feel like it, I need to be here. There's some things that I need to do. On Wednesday, yes, my schedule might not have allowed it, but because I'm royalty, my presence is mandatory. Y'all not talking to me. I can't go out and do what I want to do. I need to follow the house rules of which I'm part of the kingdom. If you keep doing your own thing, they're going to look at you. You might be royalty, but you'll be the family joker. In every kingdom, there's a paid fool. You might just be it. You might just be the one that has made people laugh at you because you never follow the commitment. The house's commitment goes over your own personal commitments. Sometimes we get it backwards. We think that our personal time is our personal time. But if God thought that about him and your relationship, God is a commitment God. If he's a commitment God, why is it it's so hard for you to be a commitment king? Why is it so hard for you to be a commitment queen? Why is it so hard for you to follow a simple house rule or two? Let's look at some of these commitments. You must have bowels of mercy. Say bowels of mercy. It's interesting that you got to tell a king or a queen in the household of faith that they got to have some kindness. Why is it that God has to continue to remind us through the writings of Paul, Peter, James, that we have to be kind to people? If we're supposed to look like God, we're supposed to act like God, why in every text, one of the fruits of the Lord that needs to be reminded is kindness? Why? Because he knows in the household of faith, there are some that want to kill Simba, want to kill Mufasa, don't want to, y'all not talking to me. Then maybe those that have seen The Lion King understand what I'm getting ready to tell you. There's somebody that, although they're in the family, although they think they have the rights to the kingdom, they don't have the rights to the kingdom because they don't act kind. They don't have the rights to the kingdom because they're not acting humble. They don't have the rights to the kingdom because they don't have bowels of mercy. What I'm saying to you, although they might be part of the family, don't mean they're in the kingdom. Let's look at this. Listen. See, I got to have some kindness. And my mind needs to be humble. I need to have some meekness. And meekness is not weakness, baby. That is just your strength under control. Sometimes we get meekness misunderstood, baby. There are people that are meek, but they are powerful. If you ever met Smokey Norfolk, if you ever met Kenneth Copeland, and you talk to them personally, if you ever talk to Pastor Parsley one-on-one like we have, you ever talk to Apostle Horton like we have, they might look meek, but when they open their mouth, they powerful. What I'm saying is meekness is not a weakness. That is just a strength completely under control. I got about another 10 minutes. Y'all yield that to me. Meekness, long suffering. That means you got to be willing to suffer a little. Y'all not talking to me. So this is the one where I lose all the kings and the queens because they're not willing to suffer a little bit. They're not willing to take a little hurt on behalf of their subjects or their family members. They're not willing to take a little pain on behalf of somebody else. Long suffering is about being able to forbear and to take on another's love, another hurts, another pain. Sometimes you got to recognize that what they're going through is not what they going through. It's a teaching method for what you're going through. Can a brother just preach a minute? The Bible goes on, it says forbearing one another. Look to your neighbor, and then it says forgiving one another. The writer puts them in right next to each other. Why? Because you can forbear and forgive. If you can forbear and forgive, that means you need to bear another one's hurts, and you need to forgive them of what they did to you. Sometimes you're not willing to, you might be willing to forbear, but you're not willing to forgive. Sometimes you're willing to forgive, but you're not willing to forbear. God put them together for a reason, so that you'd be willing to take on somebody else's hurt and bear that burden with them, but also that you'd be able to forgive them when they hurt you. Your open door to your kingdom, your open door to success is a forgiveness. Your open door to your kingdom, open door to success is you're willing to forbear somebody else's pain. Anybody hear what I'm saying? And look how God qualifies it for you. Forbear one another and forgive one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do you. Look to your neighbor and say, I get it. Forgiveness is my cloak of royalty. Woo. That, man, that's just powerful. That hit me in the cell. God just gave that to me. He downloaded that right there. Let's just put on our cloak of forgiveness. I felt royalty. That just felt like purple velvet, baby. That just felt like purple velvet. Y'all know what I'm saying. That's that royal cape. I just put it on. There you go. I like that. Go ahead. There it is. He trying to get me to preach, y'all. See, y'all think I can't do it. I can do it. And above all things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. I need y'all to, y'all committing to love somebody. And even in the midst of your stuff, you got to commit to love. Even in the midst of your troubles, you got to commit to love. God says that is what perfectly matches you up with God, when you love. The reason why we don't look like God, the reason why we don't act like God, is because we still have not learned to love yet. We have to, it goes back to February. We've been dealing with love all February. We have to recognize that love is the open door to the perfection of God. Look to your neighbor and say, love is the open door to the perfection of God. Look at this. Let's keep reading because this is good. Y'all committed to all this now. Remember that. I just, if you break one, you break them all. If you break one, you break them all. You committed to all or you commit to none. Yeah, either you all in or you all out. And when you play poker, you either all in or you fold. Say, I'm not folding. I'm all in. We ain't got no people checking neither. We ain't got none of that. Some of us might be able to raise, but we want to raise to all in. I don't gamble, but I know the rules. Let the peace of God, this is still some of the commitments now. Y'all running them down. And let the peace of God rule in your heart, to the which also you are called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Three things are in there, and I want to give them to you. First of all, you need to get the peace of God in you, right? You need to get the wisdom of God in you, and you got to have a praise in your spirit. You got to have a praise in your spirit. Look to them and say, you got to have a praise in your spirit. That means when stuff ain't going right, you got to have a praise in your spirit. When things ain't going, your finances might be low at the moment, you got to have a praise in your spirit. When trouble at home, they get ready to cut your lights out or whatever, you need to have a praise in your spirit. When things at home, marriage-wise, ain't working, you need to have a praise in your spirit. When mama them and daddy them start acting crazy, you need to have a praise in your spirit. If you got a pookie or a silly Susie in your family, you need to have a praise in your spirit. Whatever's going on in your life, you need to make sure that you always have a praise in your spirit. There might be people that in your family ain't saved and they keep trying to pull you down. You need to say, you know what? I got a praise in my spirit. There's things going on in my life that been stopping me from trying to go crazy. That's God. God put a wall, a hedge of protection around me, so I got a praise in my spirit. What I'm saying to you is my finances are getting stronger and stronger every day, because I got a praise in my spirit. My marriage and my children are saved because I got a praise in my spirit. When I go home, I got a happy, happy, joy, joy, because I got a praise in my spirit. What I'm telling you is the miracles happen because I got a praise in my spirit. When I lay hands, the sick recover because I got a praise in my spirit. When I begin to jump, I begin to feel the happies in my life, it's because I got a praise in my spirit. Anybody got a praise in their spirit? If you got a praise in your spirit, I ask you to get to your feet. I ask you to lay hands on yourself. Tell yourself, I got a praise in my spirit. Right now, I got the happy, happy, joy, joy. I got a praise in my spirit. I believe that healing is getting ready to manifest. I got a praise in my spirit. I believe my body is going to recover 100% because I got a praise in my spirit. I believe my heart is regulated because I got a praise in my spirit. I believe my wallet just got fatter because I got a praise in my spirit. I got a praise. Anybody got a praise? I feel like preaching. Anybody got a praise up in here? If you got a praise up in here, why don't you get out here and do a dance? Why don't you tell the Lord that you get ready to go someplace? You got a praise in your spirit. Something's getting ready to happen. Miracle signs and wonders are getting ready to do something in your life. There's a praise. I got a praise. I got a praise in my spirit. I got commitment to the praise of God. There we go. We got somebody understand what I'm talking about. Come on. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Look at this. I got a praise in my spirit. I got a praise in my spirit. There's a miracle in my heart because I got a praise in my spirit. I got a praise in my spirit, a praise in my feet, a praise in my hand, a praise in my head, a praise in my heart, a praise in my back, a praise in my leg. Anybody got a praise up in here? Praise him with my hands, uh-huh. Praise him with my feet, uh-huh. Devils. There it is. There it go. Somebody can deliver right there. If you got delivered just now, why don't you run? If you got a plate, then why don't you dance? I feel the presence of the Lord. Come on, come on. Let's get to the altar. Let's get to the altar. Let's get to the altar. Come on.
I got a praise.
Woo!
I got a praise that I got to get it out.
Is it okay we have church up in here? Is it okay we have a relationship with God? We get ready to get an experience with God like never before. Stomp it out. Stomp it out. You know the devil been fighting your marriage. You know the devil been fighting your finances. Stomp it out.
I got a praise.
Okay, I got about 5 more minutes. Come on, yield me that. Yield me that. Yield me that. This word so straight. Come on, come on, come on. Y'all get seated. We got about 5 minutes. Can we just worship just a little bit? Can we just worship God? It says, and whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all. This is your commitment. It's still part of your commitment. It's the last one, but probably most important. I don't know if it's most important, but they're all equally important. And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Be thankful, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Look to this and say, do all in Jesus' name. You keep in commitment that even when you acting crazy, that'll watch you to keep you from doing it. Why? Because you're doing it all in Jesus' name. Look to this and say, do it all in Jesus' name. Okay, 2 more texts and we go close. And they're related. They're related. Say, do it all. Do it all. Revelations. I told you I was going to take you from the front of the book to the end of the book. Yeah. The Bible says that whoever read this revelation shall be blessed. Look to them and say, I get it. I get this revelation. I get this revelation. Revelations 1. You got it? When you get to Revelation 1, say amen. We're going to read Revelations 1, 6, 7, and 8. And then we're going to go to Revelations 5. Can I tell you that God is the same God? The same God that called you a royal priesthood in Exodus. The same God that called you a royal priesthood elect of God in Colossians and 1 Peter. The same God that spoke to John the Revelator in Revelations. I come to tell you that if God called you royalty in the Old Testament, he called you royalty in the Middle Testament. I believe that he called you royalty in the book of Revelation. He called you royalty in the beginning, in the past. He called you royalty in the present. And he's prophesying that you're going to be royalty in your future. If it didn't take in the Old Testament, God said if it didn't, you didn't get it in the Old Testament. And you didn't get it in the New Testament. Gosh darn it. My sons and my daughter better get it in the book of Revelations. Because they royalty. Look to the next time, royalty. Revelations 1, 6, 7, and 8 says, and he has made kings and priests unto God. He made us kings and priests unto God. And his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever. Amen. Look at this. Behold, he come with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him. All kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, saith the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty. See, I'll start right there, and can I paraphrase and parenthetical insert a couple of things that God showed in the text. He wanted to tell you that I was there in the beginning. So in the beginning, you was royalty. He knew you before your mother's womb. He knew you before you knew who you were. He had already claimed you to be royalty because he was there in the beginning. He letting you know that even in your end, I was Alpha and Omega. Even in your end, even at the end of your existence here on earth, you're still going to be royalty. Even when you go on to heaven, you're going to be dancing around the throne, but you're going to be closer than those that have just made it in the door. God said he's put you in place of heavenly places. You have the ability because I was there at the beginning, and I am so also there at the end. I was there when you were born. I was there when you were formed. I was there when I made you up in my mind. Don't you know that the reason why you have the mind of Christ is because God put his mind in your spirit before you was even born. Some of us had to recognize the reason why you can't do the things that other people do is because you royalty, baby. Royal people can't go to common places. Y'all not talking to me. Royal people can't go to places that common people go. Royal people can't do the things that common people do. If they can go to the club, that's because they common, baby. You royalty. Royal people don't go to the club. Royal people do royal things, and they hang out with royal people. Kings hang out with kings and queens. Princes and earls, they don't hang out anything lower than that. If you hanging out with the common folk, then you've weakened your kingdom. Some of us are hanging out with too many common folk when we need to be hanging out with royalty, baby. If you look at your phone and all you got is common people, you need to change your people that you hang out with. You need to start hanging out with royal people. You need to hang out with people that got royalty in their blood. You need to say, you know what? I know I might be the king of Paris, the king of France, and you the king of England, but we can hang out together. Nobody wants to hang out with the king of the hood. Nobody wants to hang out with the king of the crack house. King of But we willing to hang out with the king of the whorehouse, the king of the liquor store, the king of the cigarette factory. We willing to hang out with them when they don't lower their standard. They stay keep right to their stuff. They go to the club, they drink, they smoke, they party, they fornicate, they do all of that, and they don't change what they are. But you willing to hang out with that? Tell them the ones to come to your kingdom, see what happened. They want you to come to their kingdom on Friday night and Saturday night, but you tell them, you know what? I'm not coming to your kingdom. Why don't you come to my kingdom, see what happened. He said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending. You have to recognize that God was there. Look what he says. He said, which is? He said, I am right now. He said, which is and which was and which is to come. He said, you was a king right now. You were a king and you going to be a king no matter what happens from this point on. Look to them and say, I'm a king, baby. Or I'm a queen, baby. Say, I'm royalty. Okay, let's go to Revelation 5 and we get ready to close. And we're going to read Revelation 5, 9, and 10. You get in trouble. Anybody seen the movie Aladdin? Remember when Princess Jasmine started hanging out with Aladdin before she knew Aladdin was a pauper? She got in trouble. And when she recognized Aladdin had to get his kingship before she can truly have a whole new world. You want a whole new world, baby. You want God what God has for you. You need to start acting like a king. You need to start acting like a queen. Can I share this with my princesses in the house? Princesses, right, are catered to. If you're not being catered to, he's not the man for you. Princesses are taken care of, catered to, shown difference because she's royalty. If you are not getting those benefits of your position in the kingdom, then the person catering to you is not your prince. Sometimes we lower our standard because we want a prince. But can I tell you that if there's a prince there, you have to raise a standard, not lower your standard. You are God's anointed woman of God. And God is going to send you your Prince Charming. But Prince Charming treated his queen or his princess like who she was. If he hitting on you, yelling at you, acting crazy around you, that is not your Prince Charming. That is your frog. And that frog need to jump out your life. If you got to do anything that's beneath you in order to gain his affection, That is not your Prince Charming. My princess, my princess, she's going to get the man, the Prince Charming, that she deserves. Because when he walked by, if I smell him and he don't smell like God, that's not him. Yeah. I don't care. And if he does smell like God, I don't care how much it's going to cost. I'm going to help out in that wedding. But if he come by here and he smell like doo-doo, he look like doo-doo, he act like doo-doo, I can promise you, I don't care how he might look on the outside, but if his insides are dirty, his insides don't look right, he don't smell like God, he don't look like God, he is not a prince, he is a pauper, and you need to keep away from him. I don't care about your puppy love. I care about real love. Say real love. Okay, I'm getting ready to close. I'm here, I promise you. Revelations 5. And let me just tell you, I know y'all might not be my daughter, but every daughter up in here that's a single spiritual daughter of mine, y'all need to bring him over here, this prince, and let me smell him. And let me tell you, he might smell like B.O., but if he smells like God, that's okay with me. Let me just tell you, your body odor don't determine how you really smell. You might stink because you're a hard worker, but when I smell you, you smell like God. You might work construction, but when I smell you, you smell like God. Y'all not talking to me. He might come in here, his pants are sagging and he's sweating and he got dreads, but if he walked past me and he smelled like God, I'm good. We getting ready to close. Revelations 5 and 9. You got it? He said, and they sung a new song, saying, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seal thereof, for thou wast slain. This is my last point. Y'all got to get this one. And has redeemed us to God by the blood of our ever kindred and tongue and people and nation. And has made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. 2 points in there and we're going to close. First point is, true kings inherited the kingdom by death. Queen Elizabeth got her rightful position by death. We have to recognize that some things in us got to die for us to be royal. Flesh and blood did not reveal that unto me. Some of us got to live by the Spirit. Things in us, our attitudes, our anger, our hurts, our harm, they got to die to them things. You really want to walk in your royalty. There's some things you're going to have to die to in order to receive it. And then, last point, say, I got to die because I'm royalty. Yeah. You have to know that you know that you know that you've been born to die. Yes, you were born to live. But when you die, you live eternal. He said, and has made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall what? Reign on this earth. If you do all the points of God that I laid out for you, you shall reign. Look to it, say, I shall reign. My kingdom is growing every minute here on the earth. And I thank you, God, for putting me in position to reign. I am called to reign. And I came to the kingdom for such a time as this. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise.